Well, good afternoon, and thank you all for joining me today. I want to go through about 10 different points about where we are with the soil moisture content level report, or high water event that we talk about. So I'll start with our most southerly point and start talking about Fargo. So as of today, the Red River is at 18.2 feet in Fargo, or entirely within its banks. Grand Forks, as of today, the Red River is at 35.6 feet, which is 7.6 feet above its banks. So even if we had a substantive weather event south of us, it means that we would be able to handle all that water. It would have to be fairly epic in size to have an impact now on Manitoba and on Winnipeg. So we're very pleased with the fact that the crest comes and that it seems to dissipate very quickly. The Red River has crested on April the 18th in Emerson at 788.94 feet. It has now dropped down to 788.7 feet as of this morning. The gates at St. Norbert at the floodway are operating currently under rule number one. And as of April 20th, flow is at 18,945 CFS. The crest should arrive sometime within the next 24 hours at the gates in St. Norbert. Insofar as Highway 75 is concerned, it is expected to stay open. However, the ramp on the north side of Morris on PTH 75 will remain in place in the meantime. Currently, within the north side, that's north of the city of Winnipeg, we call it the Selkirk-Netley Creek area, there are no ice dam issues currently, and the Red River, including the Netley Creek Bend, which is where we normally get a lot of the ice damming, there are no issues there right now. So no further issues at this time north of the city of Winnipeg. I want to very briefly touch on the lake levels. So Lake Winnipeg is at 714.9 feet, and its operating level is between 711 and 715 feet. That means Lake Winnipeg is within its operating level. The same can be said for Lake Manitoba, which is currently at 811.4 feet, and its operating level is between 810.5 and 812.5. Again, Lake Manitoba, like Lake Winnipeg, is within its operating level. Want to touch very briefly on the Shellmouth Dam, which is operational at outflows of 25 CFS. The water level in the reservoir is at 1,396 feet. The target level for spring is between 1,402 and 1,404 feet. So we actually are going to have to be very careful that we allow enough water to remain within the Shellmouth Dam operation. The Portage Diversion has ceased operations as of April 20th, and the reason why we operated the Portage Diversion was just to ensure that we would keep ice out of the Assiniboine. A last point I want to touch on, and that's the Fairford Dam. It is currently running at 60%, and for those of you who may not remember, the Fairford Dam is at the northern end of Lake Manitoba. I think those are sort of the main points that I did want to touch on, and I'd be prepared to take questions at this time.
Thank you, Minister. A reminder to our reporters online that we'll have a primary question and one follow-up question. From the Brandon Sun, Colin.
Hi, Minister. Colin Folk with the Brandon Sun here. At this point, is there no flood risk in the Westland area?
Well, from previous reports, you would remember that we had a very dry winter after the Remembrance Day storm. It was fairly dry out west. So the concern we have is probably more lack of moisture than of moisture. And that's why we're watching very carefully what we're doing with the Shellmouth Dam. As you know, Brandon gets its drinking water from the Shellmouth Dam. So we're going to be very careful that we ensure that there's water kept behind. We want to make sure that Brandon keeps its supply of water. So at this point in time, the answer would be there are no concerns.
Sounds good. No follow-up question.
Thank you.
From the Winnipeg Sun, Glenn.
Glenn Dawkins from the Winnipeg Sun. Mr. Minister, I guess the message today is that you've prepared for the worst, but I guess the best that you hope for is, it looks like it's going to come through. Is that easy? Is that a fair assessment that you've made the preparations, but it looks like it won't be as bad as hoped?
You know, thank you very much for that question. We're always cautiously optimistic. I would have to say I'd like to give a special shout out to the Deputy Minister of Manitoba Infrastructure, Tariq Elsabat, and the Assistant Deputy Minister, Ruth Eden, who do an amazing job running the department, running emergency measures. They're just doing a fantastic job. And they've always been very steady as she goes, and that's been our approach. We always want to make sure that we put out all the facts and the numbers. They are available on our website. And we always stated that we were cautiously optimistic that this would be a 2019 level flood. And that's about where we are. We're just, in some instances, a little above 2019 in the range of a 2006. But again, nothing to be overly concerned about. And I would like to thank all of those individuals who are involved with this, not just at management, but those who have boots on the ground who are helping right now with pumping and with, you know, closing ring dikes. They're doing a fantastic job, and they're protecting Manitobans well.
I guess my follow-up would be, so I was driving by the Red River, and there is some spillage over the Red River, at least I noticed. So there will be some, but nothing to the extent that needs to be major sandbagging, or is that sort of
right?
As in, yeah,
right. And you know, we all understand that we live at the bottom of what used to be a lake, Lake Agassiz. So, you know, we're always going to have water. And every time we have a major rainstorm, the walkway at the Forks floods, or the dock at Selkirk has water on it. It doesn't really mean that we have a major flood. It just means we have water. And that's by virtue of living at the intersection of two of the most major rivers in Canada, beautiful rivers. But I've said this before, the Red River can be temperamental, and we have to be very careful. We keep an eye on it. Like in Thanksgiving, when we had that storm, we had to use the emergency appropriations to open up open up the gates of the floodway. So we're always really careful when it comes to the Red River. We take an awful lot of water in, basically the size of two European countries. So yeah, there's a lot of water flowing right now, and it looks a little intimidating. But for individuals who live in Manitoba, people who live in Winnipeg, that's just par for the course. It's something we're used to.
From CBC Radio Canada, Gavin.
Hi, Mr. Minister. I was wondering if you could give us an update on how physical distancing may have impacted operations, whether it seemed to really slow things down at any point during ring dike building or something like that. Just wondering how it's going.
Thank you very much for that question, Merci. And that's why our department, along with the City of Winnipeg and with organizations like Manitoba Heavy Construction Association, we went out and we developed protocols. I don't know if you've had a chance to look at them. They are on the Emergency Measures Organization website under Department of Manitoba Infrastructure. And we came up with some very good protocols. I would have to say the rural municipalities, the towns, and the communities along the Red River were fantastic. We encouraged that if you thought that you might need to do some sandbagging, that you might need to do some work, how about just do it proactively? Because you're absolutely correct. The environment we're in right now would slow things down at least by one third. So if there had to be an emergency sandbagging operation, you know, factor that into it. So a lot of the communities went out and they did proactive sandbagging, and we encourage that, and we think it's worked out very well. City of Winnipeg identified a whole bunch of properties that had to be done. And it was done in the best way possible. And again, we want to thank all of our partners in the rural municipalities and the cities and towns and villages. They just were fantastic to work with. And I would have to say they really know what they're doing. And congratulations to them. They were prepared, even in light of COVID-19.
As a follow-up, do you think there will be or is there any impact on transport traffic on Highway 75?
It has to slow down when they get to the north side of Morris, and the reason for that is because they have to go over a ramp, so it's a temporary ramp. We don't let you to go, you can't really drive as fast as you normally would. You have to slow down anyway to drive through Morris, so we're slowing the traffic down a little bit. And other than that, there's really no impediment to truck traffic. It's going as smoothly as normal. From what I understand from the Manitoba Trucking Association, the border crossings are fairly smooth. Periodically they are struggling with finding washroom facilities or food locations in the United States, but even that seems to have resolved itself. So by and large, nope. Commerce seems to be moving quite well so far.
From CTV Winnipeg, Charles.
Minister Charles will say CTV Winnipeg. Just wondering about detours or road closures that have been put in effect in some of these areas due to potential flooding. Will those be reopening shortly, or will they be staying in place?
Right. Thank you very much for that question. We provided a list for you, and it's available online, which of the roads have been closed. They are, by and large, minor roads. They're not going to change the life of a lot of individuals. They tend to be lower traffic roads. And as soon as it's safe to do so once the water recedes, Manitoba Infrastructure will go in. They'll have a look at it. If we're not comfortable with the strength of the road, maybe it's been undermined by the water, we will then do an engineering study on it. We will not open up a road or a bridge until we're absolutely certain that it's safe to do so. In a lot of these instances, we're monitoring them on a daily basis. And as soon as they dry out, we open them up again.
Thank you. No follow-up.
From the Winnipeg Free Press, Ben.
Good afternoon. I'm wondering if you mentioned briefly that there's about infrastructure damage to minor roads. Is there any sort of estimate so far what the economic impact of the flooding will be? I know that's something that you guys are probably thinking about, how you're going to fund to repair things in a timely manner. Can you give us a sense of the economic impact of the flooding so far?
We would suggest that the economic impact currently has been minor. We will be looking at what kind of damage there is after the water recedes. I'm very pleased, and I know our government is very pleased, that there isn't the kind of damage we've seen in years previously. Our government has also provided $8 million to municipalities. Initially, it was to be a little bit more than $2 million, and we found out that there was an oversubscription of the fund through municipal relations, and our government decided that what we would do is we would fund the $8 million. And we're hoping that some of the money will be used for these kinds of roads that are always flooded over and over and over again. Perhaps what we should do is engineer them better and then put back a road that doesn't get flooded every time. Perhaps it's a bigger culvert. Perhaps it's something else that has to be done. But we're going to look at trying to do a secondary or different approach to not just rebuilding infrastructure that gets flooded every year. So, anyway, thank you for that question.
No problem. Thank you for the answer. And as a follow-up, I'm wondering if there have been any communities that you know that have been particularly hard hit. I know that in general, the predictions and the projections have been roughly what happened in reality. But has there been any RM or any community that's been particularly hard hit by the flooding in your world?
So far, not this year. Talking first of all about north of the city, the Netley Creek area seems to always be a problem. The ice this year was far thinner than it normally is. Normally the ice is about 3 feet thick when we start cutting. We found that in a lot of places it was down to 2 feet. So we didn't get the ice damming, which is different than ice jamming. The ice damming is usually what happens, and then we end up with flooding. So there was nothing really north of the city. South, we know that there's a couple communities that do have some roads that are underwater. We're not sure if they've been washed out. It doesn't look like they have been. Again, we won't know for sure until the water recedes, but so far we'd have to say the impact has been minor. The fact that we can keep Highway 75 open is a big thing for us as a province. It's our major connection into our major trading partner. We're really pleased with the way things have rolled out, and again, we were always cautiously optimistic, and so far it's been really good.
From Global, Will.
Yeah, hi, Minister. Will from Global. Thank you for your time. You've painted a pretty mild picture for us, but I'm just wondering, what is the level of concern that a weather event or something could complicate the plans right now?
Well, you know what? Our Canadian side of the weather forecasting, Environment Canada, has been an amazing partner. They've been very good at predicting, and they are currently not predicting any major weather events in the near future. So, you know, we're going to be looking at the crest hitting the floodway gates in St. Norbert. What we have learned from what happened in Fargo, Grand Forks, and even in Emerson is that the crest comes and goes very quickly. And if we get even 4 or 5 days of the water flowing, we should be in very good shape, even if we did end up with a severe weather event. And so far, Environment Canada, who's been amazing all the way through this, right from January, they've predicted, and their predictions have been spot on. We would say that we should be in good shape. But again, something can come out of nowhere, and all of a sudden we have a different situation, and we're always prepared for that.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for the answer. And just to bounce off of that, if you can give us a date maybe or a time where we know or we can assume that we're in the clear, so to speak?
You know what? I could always just ring a bell for you on my desk, but we'll take that as notice. And when we know that the crest is clearly through and the river levels are dropping, absolutely, we will endeavor to put out a press release and suggesting that things are now basically, you know, we're always reluctant to hang a banner on the battleship, right? Like, we don't have a battleship, and secondly, those kinds of things tend to go sideways on officials. So we're always using an abundance of caution when we say, you know, it looks like things are progressing well. We always couch it because we don't want to give people false impression that everything is great and then we get a big weather event. So, you know, certainly we'll let you know when we know that the crest is through, and once the river levels start dropping substantially, absolutely we will let you know. We'll make note of that. We can do that.
From the Carillon, Greg.
Hi, Greg Vandermeulen here from the Carillon.
Hey, Greg.
Just wondering if you have a projected date of when the ramp, for removing the ramp in Morris.
Yes, we will be removing the ramp when it's safe to do so. And because it's costly to put it up, because it has to, you have to put mud down, then you have to pack it, and then you put more down, you pack it. And it's quite a substantive ramp. We're going to leave it until we know that the levels have dropped substantially. So if you want, again, we can give you a notification when we're going to be removing the ramp. But we always use, an abundance of caution, because if we take it down prematurely and then the river all of a sudden starts coming up because there was a weather event somewhere in the valley, and then we have to put it back, it's a very costly proposition to keep putting it back. So until it's safe to do so, we will leave the ramp there.
Okay. And just to follow up, you referenced the number of communities that had ring dikes closed. Do you know what that number is and whether access was affected to those communities?
Yes. First of all, on the second part, access was not restricted, and we were running pumps so that anywhere where we close ring dikes, we make sure that we have pumps available so that if there is, you know, initially it would have been snow melt and then it's any kind of rainfall, we make sure that we're always running the pumps. All those ring dikes that have been closed are on the website, and you can get that information right from there. In fact, we provide that information on a daily basis during the week, and it can be accessed there at any time. If there's an issue with that, let my department know, and we'll ensure that you get that information.
Thank you, Minister. And this concludes today's media briefing.
Thank you all.